Good afternoon. The next item of business is portfolio questions, and the portfolio is net zero energy and transport. If a member wishes to request a supplementary, they should please press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letter R in the chat function during the relevant question. I call question number one, Jackie Dunbar.
To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting Aberdeen City Council to meet its net zero ambitions.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
The Scottish Government continues to work closely with local authorities to tackle the global climate emergency, including through the Scottish Cities Alliance. We are supporting Aberdeen City Council in a number of ways, including as a full partner of the Aberdeen City Region deal. We are contributing £125 million over 10 years, alongside an additional £254 million, which will help ensure economic transformation for the North East, with inclusive growth, increased wellbeing and a just transition to net zero. This month, we announced that our North East and Moray Just Transition Fund will provide £20 million to projects this year, representing a total value of more than £50 million over 4 years to support a fair transition to net zero and to diversify the regional economy in Aberdeen, Aberdeenshire and Moray. And we are supporting low-carbon infrastructure, green growth, accelerator pathfinder projects in Aberdeen. And alongside that, we are also providing some £75 million to the Energy Transition Fund to support our energy sector and the North East over the next 5 years to make progress on energy transition as we move towards a net-zero society by 2045.
Jackie Dunbar.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer. Aberdeen City Council has an ambitious plan with the ultimate aim of becoming a net zero and climate resilient council, with six key strands focusing on mobility, buildings and heat, circular economy, energy supply, natural environment and empowerment. Will the Cabinet Secretary join me in welcoming this ambitious plan for Aberdeen? And can he go into further detail on how communities in my Aberdeen Dawnside constituency will be able to take action to help reach the net zero goal through community empowerment legislation?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I very much welcome the work that has been taken forward by Aberdeen City Councils through their climate change plan and that of other local authorities across the country. We clearly, as a country, have a target of achieving net zero by 2045. And all parts of the public sector and the private sector need to play their part in ensuring that we achieve that target. Alongside supporting the provisions in local authorities to create greater community empowerment, we introduced the Community Empowerment Act back in 2015 to help to support communities take more control over the decisions which affect them, their economies, their wellbeing and their local environment. And this year, we have supplemented £1 million through the Just Transition Fund, which will be allocated through the Participatory Budgeting Programme in Aberdeen City, Aberdeenshire and Moray, with the aim of empowering local communities to have a direct say in how funding will be spent on projects addressing a just transition to net zero.
Thank you. And I had to take a supplementary from Colin Smith, the spokesperson. Mr. Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. Transport remains the biggest emitter of greenhouse gases, so one of the biggest barriers to councils delivering net zero. The SNP promised in their manifesto to remove fossil fuel buses, the majority, from transport in Scotland by 2023, a promise repeated in last year's programme for government. Transform Scotland's research suggests just 16% of the fleet will be electric or hydrogen powered by the end of next year. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell us, is that figure correct? And if not 2023, just when will the government meet that target?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, we are taking forward a range of work in terms of making sure that we decarbonise our bus network. And the member will be aware of the very significant level of investment the Scottish Government has already made in electrification of the bus network. However, in Aberdeen City, one of the aspects there is in relation to hydrogen buses, which we have been supporting as well, which has got the biggest hydrogen bus network in Europe, I believe, as a result of investment and support that's been provided by the Scottish Government. That's why, working with Aberdeen City Council and other partners, we've been making sure that we help to continue the decarbonisation of the bus network.
And supplementary, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary mentioned the Just Transition Fund. Now, there are about 120 applicants to the first 20 million of the fund who are desperate to get going and start making investment decisions. Now, we know that the Scottish Government has selected the successful bidders several weeks ago, but has failed to announce them. So I wonder, given that constituents have suggested to me that the announcement is being delayed until SNP conference, Cabinet Secretary, would you counter those suggestions by publishing the successful names now?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, I'm sure the member will welcome the commitment the Scottish Government has made to take forward the Just Transition Fund for the North East and Moray in particular. And we have already identified the successful projects, and those details will be announced soon by the Just Transition Minister, Richard Lockhead, as a result of the criteria which was applied in assessing these. But I would also just gently point out to the member that the North East and Moray Just Transition Plan is our fund, is a £500 million programme over the course of the next 10 years, which we have repeatedly called upon the UK Government to match, which they have failed to do. And if the government, if the member was so keen to make sure that there was more money going into the North East and Moray, he might want to try and get his colleagues in Westminster to step up and match the level of ambition that the Scottish Government has to the North East of Scotland.
Question number two, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the impact of its announced £37.7 million reduction in the budget for concessionary travel.
Minister Jenny Gilruth.
As part of our routine management of the funding for bus services, the Scottish Government continually monitors forecasted spend against budget. As a result of the demand-led nature of the concessionary travel schemes, we have reduced our forecast for the rest of this financial year due to lower-than-expected patronage. This change in the forecast will have no impact on access to the older and disabled person scheme and to the young person scheme. If patronage were now to rise above the forecasted levels, so would our expenditure on the schemes.
Faisal Chowdhury.
I thank the Minister for that answer. In its justification for the cuts to concessionary travel, the Scottish Government's statement cited forecast reduction in patronage numbers and fare levels. Given Scotland's commitments to net zero, would it not make more sense to address the reduction in numbers rather than using them to justify cuts? Is this not another false economy from the Scottish Government?
Minister.
I thank the member for his supplementary question. I think it's worthwhile pointing out that the reduction in patronage has been impacted, of course, than a slower than normal return to patronage than was previously the case. And that has been reflected in reforecasting going forward. I think, of course, similarly under the older and disabled person scheme, that remains around about 30% below 2019 levels. And we know that bus patronage has been slower than other modes of public transport to return to pre-pandemic levels. However, I recognise what the member has said. Of course, we do provide support to the sector more generally. And earlier in the year, I extended the NSG Plus grant, which existed during COVID. That has been extended into next month. And next week, I will be reconvening the bus task force directly with the sector. I met with smaller operators and larger operators over the course of summer recess to talk about some of the very real challenges they face. And to the member's point in relation to pulling people back to public transport, he may be aware that only 2 weeks ago now, we launched the marketing campaign for the Young Persons Bus Scheme, which has been really successful. We're now over the halfway mark, which is hugely important, and we will continue to encourage people to return to public transport, because that's vital in terms of our recovery from the pandemic and, as the member has mentioned, in terms of our net zero ambitions and aspirations.
And I have some supplementaries, and the first one from Paul McLennan, please.
Thank you. Over 2.3 million people in Scotland, everyone under 22, everyone over 60, and disabled people and carers can now benefit from free travel for work, education and leisure opportunities. This policy has been taken forward against a backdrop of the Scottish budget being cut by 5.2%. Does the Minister agree with me if Labour would rather not see the Scottish Government have to make tough decisions? It's time they joined the SNP and Greens in calling for this Parliament to have the full range of levers to realise its aspirations rather than remain at the mercy of a UK Government.
Yes, I would agree with the sentiment of the member's question. We know, particularly I think over the course of the past week, some of the challenge that the government faces, and of course will be coming forward looking at potentially future support. That will be informed by the Scottish Government's emergency budget review, but it's really important now that I think any additional support we're able to give continues to adapt and to evolve to make sure it remains fit for purpose. That's why I was really keen to reconvene the bus task force to speak to the sector directly to ensure that funding and support going forward is fit for purpose. But also, I think, recognising the limitations in terms of the powers of this government in relation to revenue. And I hope that is reflected in some of the sentiment from the members from other parties who I'm sure we're about to hear from, Presiding Officer.
And supplementary, Mark Ruskell.
Thank you. Free bus travel for under 22s was launched during the COVID crisis. So the fact that there's been 22 million journeys, I think, is pretty remarkable. And I know from discussions with bus companies that those journeys have really helped to build services back coming from the pandemic. But there is still a reluctance, Minister, from over 60s to come back to public transport post-COVID, which I think can affect the viability of some services. So can I ask the Minister how the message can be sent out that bus travel in Scotland is both safe and free for millions of people who are eligible at both ends of that concessionary scheme?
Minister.
I thank the member for his question, and he's right to point out the reticence perhaps of certain groups in society to return to public transport, as I alluded to in my response to Mr Chowdhury. Of course, the Scottish Government does continue to invest £300 million annually to give free bus travel to over 2 million people in the country. That includes children and young people under 22, disabled people and everyone over 60. And in line with our long-term goal to encourage that modal shift to get people out of their cars and back into sustainable modes of transport like bus, we will continue to engage with operators, as I've mentioned in my responses to previous members, but also with delivery partners and other key stakeholders to promote public transport as an attractive way to travel as more people begin to return to the workplace and travel for leisure purposes more often.
And supplementary, Graeme Simpson.
The concessionary travel budget is not the only source of funding that bus operators are set to lose. The Network Support Grant Plus is due to end in 10 days' time. And if that happens, routes will go, fares will rise, and the frequency of services will drop. Now, England's bus recovery grant has been extended to April, so will the Minister commit to doing the same here?
Minister.
I thank the member for his question. The member actually raised this matter with me, I think, prior to summer recess, and he knows that I did extend the NSG Plus grant at that time. I do think, though, going forward, it's really important that the support from government adapts to where we are in the current context. We've heard from other members previously today around about some of the financial challenges the government faces. We did budget to give £93.5 million from April of this year to support the bus network as we recovered from the pandemic. And there was also an additional £20.5 million funding already given to extend recovery until October, as he mentioned. This is in addition, though, to around £210 million that we've already provided during the pandemic to ensure that operators are well positioned and at the forefront of our green recovery. But I think it is worthwhile mentioning to the member, as he raises the point in relation to challenges faced by the sector, that there are a number of other challenges that don't sit with my responsibilities as a minister in this parliament. So there are challenges in relation to labour in terms of Brexit. I've discussed this with the sector. There are also challenges in relation to fuel costs. Again, there are limited actions that we can take in this parliament in that regard. Now, many of these matters are reserved, of course, to the UK government, and he may be interested to know that I have invited the UK government to take part in the reconvened bus task force next week. And I very much hope that they will take part in the task force, noting the reserved competencies which neither the member nor I have responsibility for.
Question number three, not lodged. Question number four, Emma Roddick.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it has had discussions with Ofgem regarding reported higher standing charges for energy in the Highlands and Islands.
Cabinet Secretary.
The increase in energy prices in recent months, it remains a huge worry for many consumers. That's especially true for those in the Highlands and Islands, where the additional cost of distributing energy are higher than in other parts of the country. The structure of customers' energy bills, including standing charge levels, is reserved to the UK Government. While this means that we have no option to intervene directly, we continue to provide consumers with as much support and advice as we can, as well as raising specific issues of concern with the UK Government and Ofgem.
Emma Roddick.
Thank you. It is clear from this and so many other penalties that the Highlands and Islands face for being a net exporter of clean, green energy that the UK Government will never work for the communities that I represent, instead leaving them to suffer extreme fuel poverty. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that we could and should do much better in Scotland and call for energy policy to be devolved?
Cabinet Secretary.
I do recognise the specific concerns that the members' constituents have and the higher costs which they face in rural and remote islands in meeting their energy charges. And the existing mechanism, to some extent, penalises individuals who live in these remote and rural areas as a result of the way in which Ofgem and the UK Government regulate the process. What I can say to the member is that where we have got scope to take action, we are. So, for example, through our area-based schemes, we provide funding to deliver energy efficiency improvements in areas where there's the highest levels of fuel poverty. And we've committed to continuing our spend to spend more per head in our remote and rural areas because of the significant higher levels of fuel poverty there and the additional costs associated with the works that are necessary. But the member, I think, hit the nail on the head. Given the absolute shambles we've had with the UK government over the management of energy policy over an extended period of time, there's absolutely no doubt in my mind that an independent Scotland will be able to manage our energy policy in a much more effective way that reflects the constituents' needs in areas such as the Highlands.
And supplementary, Liam MacArthur.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. As Emma Roddick suggested, and as the Cabinet Secretary has acknowledged, there's been a particular issue of late in relation to the standing charges, where the lifting of the cap in April saw a 1 pence per day increase for gas, but a doubling to 45 pence per day for electricity. Does he agree that in justifying that, there's been a suggestion that this is to pay back the monies lost from companies going bust over the past couple of years, many of which could not be used by customers in the Highlands and Islands to switch because of the total heating, total control mechanism? And will he agree to engage directly with Di Alexander, Chairman of Highlands and Islands Housing Association Affordable Warmth, about the sorts of representations that can, I think, quite legitimately be made to Ofgem and to UK ministers about the inherent unfairness in the way that those standing charges have been structured?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, on the member's final point, if Mr Alexander wants to write to me about his proposals, I'm more than happy to share that with my officials and our representations we've made to UK Government on this matter. There's absolutely no doubt in my mind, I think the member rightly highlights the impact that standing charges have on those who live in our remote and rural communities, including on our island communities such as Orkney. And that's why the system needs to be reformed, as it is presently calibrated in such a way that it actually penalises those who live in our remote and rural communities. And in the member's point about the issue of whether some of these costs are associated with the market failure, what has happened here is that quite literally the companies who were unhedged in their energy purchasing have gone bust. And as a result of that, the taxpayer is having to pick up the tab. The reason that has happened is because the UK government's regulator allowed unhedged companies to operate in the market. It should never have been allowed in the first place. And the billions of pounds that consumers right across the country are now going to have to pay back as a result of this falls squarely at the UK government's door and their failure to regulate the energy markets properly on behalf of consumers.
Question number 5, not lodged. Question number 6, Rachel Hamilton.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its peatland restoration plans.
Minister Mary McCallan.
Presiding Officer, in recognition of the huge importance of our peatlands in the fight against the climate and nature crisis, in 2020 we set out ambitious plans to invest more than £250 million over a decade, and that to restore 250,000 hectares of degraded peat by 2030. We published updates against these targets in our annual climate change plan monitoring reports. The latest of these was published on the 26th of May this year, and it's available on the Scottish Government website.
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Restoring peatlands will help us, as the Minister said, fight climate change, support biodiversity and provide good green jobs in rural communities. And those are words lifted straight from the Scottish Government website. But I also would like to repeat what the Minister said. And on page 70 of the SNP's 2021 manifesto is a promise to restore, as she said, 250,000 hectares of peatland by 2030. Yet this government is failing dramatically, falling short of these targets. Instead of that, it's almost halving its £22 million commitment to peatland restoration. And to meet their targets, this government will need to restore, on average, 31,250 hectares of peatland per year until 2030. How does it intend to do so?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I might have thought that nearly 60,000 hectares of peatlands, once degraded, once emitting carbon, now restored, now sequestered in carbon would be a good thing and something that even the Tories could welcome. However, I do acknowledge that peatland science is in its infancy, the peatland industry is in its infancy, and that's exactly why the Scottish Government is doing everything we can to support the industry, to provide that £250 million of funding over 10 years, why Peatland Action, part of Nature Scot, our nature agency, has been working since 2012 to support restoration projects throughout the country. This is an industry in its infancy. It is only a few years old. Contractor capacity is limited. The number of technical advisers is limited. But the Scottish Government is working at pace to bridge that gap and to meet our ambitious targets.
A supplementary, Fiona Hislop.
I would like to declare my role as Scottish Environment Link's nature champion for Scotland's extraordinary blanket bogs. Blanket bogs in Scotland equate to a third of the carbon held in the Amazon rainforest. With this extraordinary resource at our disposal, does the Minister agree with me that these lands must be systematically restored in order to help Scotland reach its climate change targets? And will the Minister commit to work closely with industry partners, including, for example, onshore renewable electricity companies, to ensure peatland restoration is a prime consideration of permissions and ensure that NPF4 planning guidance ensures renewable energy generation on these lands deliver peatland restoration in partnership in a sensible and pragmatic way to protect this vital asset as well as delivering net zero targets?
Minister.
Yes, I absolutely agree with Fiona Hislop. Peatland restoration is an absolutely essential part of the linked challenge of climate and nature crises, and it has the quite unique opportunity to provide co-benefits across our environment, our economy and our society. And yes, I will commit to continuing to engage very closely with the renewables industry as we work to transition to net zero, and this includes how the industry can balance the actions they can provide for greenhouse gas mitigation and indeed for protecting our natural world. And the Member is absolutely correct. Scotland's planning system is going to play an absolutely vital role in responding to climate change, encouraging nature recovery and in helping to deliver that crucial infrastructure that's needed to achieve our ambitions. And I shouldn't like to preempt the outcome of the final NPF4, but it will signal a turning point for planning. And we've been very clear that responding to the twin challenge of climate change and nature loss will be central to it.
Question number 7, not lodged. Question number 8, Mark Griffin, who is joining us remotely. Mr. Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how many households it has written to promoting the Warmer Home Scotland scheme since the start of the cost of living crisis.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Households can obtain free help and advice through various routes, including direct mail to households living in or at risk of fuel poverty. For example, local authorities write directly to property owners in areas targeted by our area-based schemes, but may also refer them to Home Energy Scotland and our Warmer Home Scotland service. We don't keep a central record of these activities. Yesterday, we also launched our one-stop cost of living website, which provides a wide range of advice, including schemes to tackle fuel poverty.
Mark Griffin.
I draw members' attention to my register of interest as an owner of a rental property in North Lanarkshire. I just thank the Minister for his answer. In recent parliamentary questions, the Minister has advised that Home Energy Scotland is meeting its targets to speak with low-income, potentially fuel-poor clients, with 42,000 offered support in the last financial year. But the number of installations as a result of those interactions was just 5,300. Can I ask the Minister if the Government has, while the Government does have targets for interactions and advice calls, what would the targets be for the number of installations under the new contract? And does that new contract allow enhanced promotion of the scheme with local delivery teams on the ground able to make referrals directly?
Minister.
Thank you. Well, I'd be happy to engage with members across the chamber in terms of the development of the new contract. But as things stand, Warmer Homes Scotland, which is, of course, a demand-led scheme, while it was impacted by the COVID pandemic, more than 5,300 households were supported in 2021-22. That's among the highest figures since the scheme began. We are leading the way, I think, within these islands in supporting households in fuel poverty. And in fact, Andrew Warren, chairman of the British Energy Efficiency Federation, recently wrote, "My advice to Whitehall is simple. Whether you take the high road or you take the low road, you had best be copying Scotland's initiatives." So we'll continue to develop and seek to go further. But I think we are making excellent progress in supporting people in energy during these difficult times.
I have three requests for supplementaries. I would like to take all three, but I would need to appeal for succinct questions and answers. Supplementary from Willie Rennie.
Over the last 5 years, home installation schemes have been completed in fewer than 1,000 projects in my North East Fife constituency. That's 1,000 out of 40,000 homes. In the middle of a climate emergency and now a cost of living crisis, I have to say that level of support is pathetic. How's the government going to get more homes insulated and quickly?
Minister.
Well, I'm sorry that Mr Rennie chooses to denigrate the work of not only the government but our partner agencies, which, as I said, have supported among the highest numbers in 21-22 since Warmer Homes Scotland began. I don't think there's any need for that kind of language about the work that people are doing right throughout this country to support people with the cost of living crisis, including the cost of energy. There's a huge amount more to do, not only in the current context, but throughout this decade to retrofit our homes, not only for energy efficiency, but for zero emissions heating. And I hope that in future we'll see political parties right across the chamber joining with us in making sure that we pursue that as ambitiously as we can.
Supplementary, Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you. To ask the Minister if the Scottish Government has assessed how many households are excluded from receiving external wall insulation through the Warmer Homes Scotland scheme due to living in non-traditional steel-framed houses, and what financial support might be available to those who don't qualify for this essential work but would like to improve the insulation of their homes to save energy.
Minister.
Well, Warmer Homes Scotland provides a bespoke package of energy efficiency and heating improvements that are suitable for each specific property. £55 million was allocated in 2022-23. That's the highest ever. And over 70,000 fuel-poor households that have benefited from external wall insulation as part of the area-based schemes. This does include non-standard construction, properties with non-standard construction and steel frame. We've allocated £64 million to local councils for these schemes to support the improvement of hard-to-treat properties. And I would encourage everybody, whatever kind of property they live in, to contact Home Energy Scotland to explore the support that's available to them.
A supplementary, Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I refer members to my register of interest. Minister, there are 530-plus houses, social houses in Wick that require to be upgraded to EPCC. I estimate that could cost in excess of £20 million. If you extrapolate that across the Highlands, the cost of getting social housing up to EPCC could be well in excess of £100 million. Is the government going to help those houses get up to EPCC?
Minister.
We absolutely do work closely with the social housing sector, not only to understand the scale of the challenge that confronts them, but to support them through it. We'll continue to do that, both in terms of energy efficiency and the critically important role that registered social landlords can have in developing heat networks relevant in both rural and urban settings. And just today, we launched the Heat Network Support Unit, which will be an excellent support for the development of those local projects in the years to come.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions, and there will be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.